This is a panel discussion on data-driven UX. So we're going to be talking about how to measure and optimize the user experience. So we've got three panelists. I'm the moderator. My name is Lauren Puckett. I work at Pendo. I'm the director of user experience design there. And my background has been in the visual design arena. So I got into UX through that path and have been doing that for about 8 years. Kind of a generalist most of my career, so the full spectrum of everything from customer research all the way to like really close collaboration with engineering. So that's kind of my history. I'm going to start with intros, so we're going to go through here, and you can just introduce yourself, talk a little bit about your background, company, and
okay. Can you all hear me okay? Is this a good distance? My name is Nova Brown. I'm a senior manager of UX research and strategy. So within the context of my team, that means everything from discovery all the way to visual design handoff. My background is actually in content strategy. So I came into UX via content strategy. And for us, that was always like know your audience first. So that was a really great pairing with research. So my career spans about 20 years in agency and in-house, in marketing and in product for huge companies like Walmart.com, Blue Shield of California, TiVo, Wells Fargo, two really small like art houses and restaurants and stuff like that. So my experience that I'll be talking about will be across that spectrum.
I'm Nicholas Johnson. I've been a UX designer for 15 years. I'm a senior UX designer at SciQuest. And throughout my entire career, I've designed enterprise software, starting from the government, financial industry, and now procurement software. So when large companies need to set up procurement and contracting and sourcing, lots of different, basically, enterprise applications. And I've always had an interest in making bad products better. But the thing that really got me into user experience was Butterfly Ballot, which I'd be happy to talk with you more about afterwards, if for those of you who don't know about it. That's it.
Well, I'm Ty Cameron, Christopherson Business Travel out of Salt Lake City. We're the 11th largest travel agency in the nation. And I am the director of IT and UI UX, and you're wondering, like, why do you have those two titles? That's kind of bizarre. We booked about $600 million last year, so we're pretty large now. When I started 7 years ago, we were like 200,000. So we tripled in size since I've been there. And because of that, we were an IT shop that just started building tools, became the accidental software company. And so I still had to maintain all that stuff I did on the IT side, from full stacking servers and racking them and software and desktop support to UI. And honestly, that's where my passion is in UI UX, because if any of you are in IT or know that related field, is very thankless. Everyone's mad at you when things are broken. So I'm pretty happy to be in UX, where you can actually make a difference in people's lives by building good products.
Cool. All right, so first big question. Let's just talk high level about what do you do when you have a tool, an analytics tool of some sort, and you have just data coming in? How do you make sense of that data? Where do you start? What do you do to get started, I guess?
So I work for a really pretty large organization. I forgot to say what that was. It's a civic tech company that automates really complicated workflows. So we do workflow efficiency. So you can imagine that we have a lot of different data coming in. The first thing, you know, depending on who I'm talking to, so if someone who's never used data before, you know, I would say to them, like, well, what's the question that you want answered? So if you're using it for your marketing site, like, where do people go from your homepage is a really, really easy, simple question that you can go into your analytics tool and answer. And that is, like, I think of data as, like, the gateway drug for research, and it's the gateway drug for breaking down silos between departments. So something like that, someone can really sink their teeth into. And then for teams, like, what do you do with the data? I think I think actually Nicholas is gonna talk about this in more depth, but one of the things that you wanna do is make sure that you are tailoring your data to your audience. And I wanna give you the chance to talk about that, and then I can add to that a little bit later.
Well, before I go into that, I actually like to start the conversation about what to do with Pendo data. First, can I just get a show of hands, maybe? How many people have had Pendo for less than 1 year? Okay, great. Okay, so, and how about less than 6 months? Okay, so a bunch of folks who are probably new to Pendo. One of the things that you need to do when you get started going with it is basically get some quick wins, make use of your data right away. You'll probably be overwhelmed, you know. At SciQuest, we had hundreds of millions of transactions, and the thing that gave the most value right away was actually just look at the navigation, because in most web applications, your navigation is often something that everybody has to do one way or another, whether they like to or not. If you look at your navigation, start by tagging all of that and then seeing where do people go after that. I was actually really surprised to find that a third of people click on the wrong category, and then 80% of people, the thing they do after they navigate is they search. So right away from a UX perspective, since that's where I'm coming from, is I knew, okay, we've got some serious problems with our navigation. Let's promote search and let's get our navigation more intuitive so we don't have a third of people clicking on the wrong category. So those are just two takeaways there. But But in more general sense, you need to know, like, what is it that means value for your company? And I think I'll let Ty talk a little bit about how he gets value as well before I go into that.
Yeah, well, I think Nick has a good point, is you want to start, a good place to start if you don't know where or have any idea is navigation. But one thing, you come to these conferences and you get super excited and your mind's turning, you're like overwhelmed, what do I do with this data? I can track everything now what do I do with it? I think you really got to set some strategy and define, you know, what does product adoption or success mean to you and your company? And once you can kind of define that, then narrow in on a couple key metrics that will help define that. Because if you take all this data in the world, this is awesome, it's too much to digest. But if you take some small chunks, just answer some simple questions first, like Nick said, you know, get some key wins from the start, you'll be a lot more successful. Because I don't know, I started getting Pendo and we started tagging everything and it was like, now what? But so set some strategy and ask some questions that you want to answer, so when you start tagging stuff, you have a direction.
Do you have any additional anything to add on, like, what are the questions? Because both of you, two of you have actually mentioned, like, what are the questions that you ask?
Yeah, so in my organization, I'm the person that's getting Pendo into every single product, and I'm trying to win over every team with the data that we're pulling out of Pendo to try to get them to adopt it and use it. So for, like I said, for the marketing site, one of the quickest things I could do was tag the homepage and show them the heat map. So, like, where are people clicking is a really, really great intro question, so that they can see, oh, look, you know, people are totally using the nav, or they're using the home logo to get everywhere. So we learned that. And then where are people going from the homepage? That question I asked earlier, I was able to show using the paths tool, like, people are actually going back to the homepage instead of using the nav every single time they need to get to a different solution. So we need to work on our nav, maybe. That's a good mm-hmm. question. And then within our tools, so some of our actual products are our payment products, and we're able to say, like, how many people are dropping off during the payment process? It's a really great intro question to any of the data. So how many people are dropping off in what your core path is in your product? And then if you have a new feature, you might want to ask, like, how many people are using that feature? But so for me, those intro questions really are the hook to get people into the data.
Okay. Do you have any of you guys have anything to add to questions?
No, I was just going to highlight the importance exactly of making sure that you've you're helping different parts of your organization get value out of Pendo. Often the way organizations work is one group sort of champions the purchase of it. But really any analytics tool is going to happen probably this way, where one group takes ownership or champions it, but getting that data throughout the organization is truly important. So, you know, what are the interests of each group? So customer success, product management, UX, marketing, each have their own thing. And if you can get them into analytics, then it's really powerful for it to be spread across the organization.
Yeah, I mean, just to add to that, I think you've got to really create a culture, a data-driven culture at your organizations to really get buy-in. Because, you know, there's some parts of organizations that don't care about data. But if you can get them excited about that and they can start talking around data, that's where you're going to drive a lot of success. Because, we had a situation at Christopherson, well, as we're getting started with Pendo, we saw some data and we said, you know what, this tool is super valuable. We're seeing all this usage coming through data through Pendo. We're doing great. The truth is, we sat down and that wasn't the case. The users were kind of forced to use it, and they didn't really enjoy it. So there's still I think we'll get into that a little later, the qualitative versus quantitative data and how you can approach that. But
cool. So let's talk about some specific stories around how you've used data to make decisions in your jobs.
Yeah, I have two stories. So you'll tell me if I'll tell you the first one, which is like such a quick win, embarrassing disaster of a little story, but that got us a quick win. Which was I was so excited. I had just tagged all the pages and all the features in this new product we were implementing it in. I took a screenshot. And I was like, we have data, everyone. And I dropped it into HipChat. I'm like, this is so exciting. We've got this. It's the login page, right? There's the username, password, login on the bottom. There's a login on the top right. And, you know, I was able to look at the numbers. I'm like, 5,000 people are clicking on this button in the past week. 29,000 people are clicking up on top. And the PM was like, that's not a button on top. I'm like, what do you mean? Why is it there? Well, there was a login on the top that was their page header that 29,000 people in the past week had clicked on, and only 5,000 people had clicked on the login button. And I'm like, what are you talking about? So I was able to quickly throw a ticket into Atlassian and get them to like fix that. Like, we need to remove this header off the login page. Everyone knows that this is our home page, and nobody needs to be clicking on that. So that's like a really quick, everybody, we've got the data and now we can get rid of this. And the only reason I tagged it is because I thought it was a button, and I'm the UX lead on that project. So that was just a like, wow, this thing really needs to be, and we're redesigning it. So that was just we wanted to set the baseline for the current project.
Yeah, and perhaps every Pendo customer has example stories like that. So mine is, and I think these fall kind of under the category of prioritizing development. So in the bad old days before analytics, you know, as a designer, I would have to explain, well, this is important that we redesign this and try to make an argument or maybe use my networking to schmooze it up with the right person. But now with data on board, I had a similar example where I was just kind of going through the application one day and I clicked on product search and I had forgotten to enter any keywords, and it comes up with this, hey, you forgot to enter keywords. You got to enter keywords. And it's just this nasty little experience. And I was thinking, oh, well, that's pretty ugly, but it's probably not very many people that experience that. So just on a whim, I go and tag it to see how many people are going through that experience. And it was just 10,000 a day. So before, it would have been, you know, really difficult to prioritize the development resources to go and fix that. But when armed with data, it was a cinch, and it was a good improvement. You know, I don't know how to necessarily put like a monetary ROI on it, but as far as the experience goes, it was a significant improvement for those 10,000 people every day. Do you want to tell a story?
Yeah, I think just talking about creating a culture of data, I came across an interesting meme recently. It said, "In God we trust, all others must bring data." And I think that speaks to what Nick's saying. Arm yourselves with the data so you can answer the questions and have the proof to back it up, because that's how you're going to get buy-in. But I had a really small example of using the data to make an improvement. And it wasn't actually a Pendo, because I know we want to create a bigger discussion than just using Pendo. But we were developing a product where it had a configuration page, and there was a lot of settings and whatnot. And we were trying to figure out, what should be the defaults, because we got a lot of people going and configuring and spending time setting up the product before they could even use it. So I went to the dev team and I said, "Hey, I want to figure this out scientifically, because UX should really be a science and not an art." And I said, "Can you tell me what are the, just percentage-wise, what are the defaults of all these things that people are setting?" And he got me a list of them, and we found out that a lot of the settings people had to change from the default to get to where they wanted. And so we just made the majority use case those defaults based off usage.
Yeah, that's awesome.
That reminds me of something kind of similar. So not just about prioritizing development, but also kind of choosing like which design to use over another can also be informed by data. Even just like a widget design, we had this widget where a developer was like, "Hey, I don't really like this. What if we do this?" And so as a designer, I can of course say, "Well, this widget really, there's four use cases when somebody would interact with this. In this one, design A is better. In this one, design A is better. This one, design A is better, but in this one, design B is better. Well, how do we make a decision between these two designs?" Well, that's where usage statistics really comes in useful. And if actually the majority of people are using it for use case four, then maybe we should tend toward, choose design B. But if not, then we would choose design A. So I've also found it very useful there.
I'm trying to talk about weaving it into other processes.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, we talked a little bit about some quick wins and just being pulling data, like some ad hoc data. But one of the ways that that we fold data and research into our design process is we have really specific design sprint process that is, we do 2-week sprints. Each design sprint is kicked off with a design studio that has as a component the research and the analytics folded into it from the previous sprint. So the researcher's job every sprint is to collect the data about our personas, develop our personas, and then interview real people, and then fold all of that information into the next sprint. And we do that in our design studio by presenting that data that we have collected, so presenting those insights, presenting the personas that we developed from those insights, and then based on those personas, do real live user interviews to show what the workflows are in that product that we're sprinting on, and what the pain points are, and how we need to fix them, and then we ideate in that 2-hour session. The next 2-week period is spent actually coming up with the mock-ups for that sprint. So for us, data and that real live research of what people are actually doing in the product and then talking to actual users based on the hypotheses that we got out of that data is a real component for all of our design sprint in the process.
That's really cool.
Yeah, and actually persona development through analytics is something that has surprised me, because when I first studied about personas, I thought, you kind of should have some idea of what the personas are before. But it's surprising if you set up different segments and kind of look at behaviors on those segments and then tweak them, you can actually learn a lot about the users, not just as one, of course, they're not one general collective. They have different personas. And when redesigning another product, actually that was another story of how we've used analytics before, is that there was one product where it was, folks were going in and bidding on a sourcing event. We thought, they're all the same kind of user, but not at all. They were using it three very different ways, and then we were able to develop personas, find folks who represented them, interview them, and go even much deeper. So I think segmentation is really valuable. Yeah, great question. So the way that I develop some segments, and it's sort of, it's a research process, right? So you develop some hypotheses, you go and look what that segment looks like, and then see if it actually looks different from another segment. But basically, like, there are, in our application, page access is driven by roles and other things. So instead of needing to like go and look, inspect role distribution in our application's database, we were able to just say, has this person ever landed on this page? And have they used this thing, let's say, more than 10 times in the last month, for example? I mean, there's a tremendous amount of flexibility in the page and feature usage based on time and frequency.
Same in our software. Usually you can tell, like, if somebody's running reports regularly in our finance software, we know that person is probably this particular role in that financial institution, and so we can then base that and, you know, create a persona for them and then do an interview with somebody like them.
Yeah, and if you don't have fully fleshed out personas yet, it's fun to create a segment and then create a segment that's everything but that segment and then go and look at that. And then, oh, what about this one? What if I take that out? And then so that's one way to explore with the segments. And that's another good thing that a new company using Pendo could do and start to see some value right away.
Either of you have any other things to add about threading data into your process or how you work with it throughout the process, anything like that? You don't have to. We can.
I think that goes back to strategy. When you're in the business requirements phase, really decide, you know, what if you're trying to build a minimal viable product, what does that mean? And what does it mean to succeed with adoption? Because if you don't ask those questions, if you don't have the questions to ask, then you're not going to know which data you're going to need to pull in. And, you know, like the question of the roles and how you're doing this. You know, our application is all permission-based, and so we didn't have roles per se, but we had a group of permissions. So what we did on the back end is that we took a collection of these permissions, defined it as a group or a role, and then passed that into our snippet. So you know, you could find different ways to group and categorize your users, but you really have to have the questions or data you want to track in there. We had to come up with a couple different things that we pass in Pendo, including excluding some data. You can blacklist, but one thing we had in our setup is that you could log in as another user. And when you logged in as that user, you took over their session, and therefore the tracking was all, you know, it was fake. It was some internal user acting as a client. So, you know, we worked with our dev team to figure out, you know, what triggered using opening that session as another user and then passing a Boolean into the snippet that said, hey, this isn't, and then I could pull that out of the segment and exclude them.
Yeah, good segue to one of our other questions about, has data ever failed you? Whether it's like giving you the wrong information or being used for evil or something, you know. Data is not always perfect.
I have a related answer.
Okay.
But if one of you have a very direct answer to that, has data ever failed?
I'll do a quick one there. So one mistake that I made early in our analytics exploration was, I was so excited about it. I wanted to report on all this data. So I would often report to my management findings that were basically like 90% data, 10% finding. And of course, they just TLDR'd it. So too long, didn't read it. And the findings were lost, and so I actually flipped that around, 90% finding, and maybe a little bit about the data at the very end, and the result, the outcomes and results of that approach were much better. So not too much data.
I mean, I think Nova's story that she's going to tell is pretty good, but like just kind of what I alluded to before, a failure we had in data is that, you know, the data was telling us this product's being used, and when we sat down with the users, it wasn't being used. And so I don't think any amount of data is going to substitute sitting down and talking to your users, but you can't do that all the time. So, but the other thing is where data can fail is in the story, and I think this is probably more Nova's thing. Is you can manipulate the data to tell any story you want, and that's good and bad, you know, and a lot of people will use that to tell their story, and it may or may not be true.
And before we go too far away from data in the process, I actually wanted to add one more thing. So One insight that most organizations want to know, and this actually has been a theme in a few of the other speakers today, is product adoption. So we invest all this money into creating, developing, deploying these features, these capabilities within our product suite. Were they actually adopted? We tend to want to answer that question well after we developed them, but by then you forget. So in my experience, it's great during the development process to actually, if you can, like if you have Jira and you can tag your Jira tickets where you're doing development to say, hey, this one is important. We want to track the adoption of this, or at the epic level, or however your process is, keep track when you're actually doing it so that you can go back and measure adoption later and determine, because until it's really deployed in your product, you're not necessarily going to be able to tag it as a feature that would be trackable for product adoption. So do it while you're still developing, you won't forget, and then once it's out there, you can go and tag it and then start tracking on it. So that's one advice about data in your process.
Let's hear the story.
really, really high expectations were set for the story. This is more of a how, like the wrong way to use data. So I was working at Wells Fargo, and it was Wells Fargo Wholesale Division. It's a platform with 80 financial products that are sort of interrelated, all on one platform. We had a whole insights and analytics team, which was a completely separate team. You had to submit a ticket to get the data that you wanted. You told them what questions you want answered, and in 2 months, they would provide you with the data. And so that created a very like scarcity culture around data for us. So so I often didn't get what I needed out of them, but instead, the director of UX came to me and said, here's a 140-page slide deck of a bunch of paths and funnels and usage data for our 80 product platform. Make a story out of that that we can give to the executives. And I'm flipping through that. These weren't questions that I had asked. The data was related. I mean, I was in charge of maybe 13 to 22 products at a time, but not all the products. I was the content strategist, so I was really only interested in user assistance within the product. And I was faced with 140 slides of data that I was then supposed to make a story out of. So I advise against that kind of here's the hunk of data story, and really to take a look at, you know, as we've talked about, and I don't think the specific question was asked, but like, how do you decide what to track, and how do you make it relevant to the people that you are talking to, which was the epic failure on my director's part there, and possibly on the insight team. But you really need to know who you're talking to, and not just give a data dump, but make a narration out of that data. So it's not just 150 people clicked on this thing, but how is that significant to your audience? How is that significant to your design team? And what conclusion can you draw from that? And I encourage the people on my team to come up with a conclusion, and not just to leave people saying like, oh, they have data, great. But like, oh, they have great data, and they made a decision based on that data. As the research team, we need to have a position. So I don't ever want somebody to walk away not knowing what our position is. So that I feel like is the more like, now what are we going to do with it kind of approach. Oh, you didn't ask a question. I'm passing it down.
Oh, it's fine. Yeah. So okay. So we've talked a lot about the quantitative data and how we bring that into the UX process, but you know, we've skimmed over like one of the biggest parts of a UX person's job, which is user interactions, like talking to users and the qualitative piece of it. So let's talk about how do you pair together the quantitative with the qualitative and make sense of that?
Well, I have a lot to say on this, but I'll try to keep it short. So, well, first, one of the real quick wins for qualitative data is in application recruiting is awesome to say, hey, I just saw that you used this. We're redesigning it. Would you like us to, or would you have 30 minutes for an interview we'd like to set up with you? Totally valuable. So there's that. What we set up at SciQuest, we called the User Experience Scorecard. Actually, pretty similar if you guys were in the Rapid 7 Product Engagement Index, except possibly a little bit further. So what we did, in order to decide what to measure, we identified, okay, what are the top tasks of our product? So what constitutes success of our product, each portion of our product we call modules. And then after somebody completes those, some random percent of those people completing the task would be invited to answer a few simple questions. So submitting your shopping cart was easy to do from strongly disagree to strongly agree scale. Also, it met your requirements, strongly disagree to strongly agree. It would, you know, overall, how satisfied were you with it? Strongly disagree to agree. And then a final, if you'd like to leave us comments. And that scorecard for each of our key top task areas was totally valuable because it identified, you know, what are the pain points within our top tasks. And not just that, you can then pair it with usage data to say, oh, well, this search gets a lot of usage and it's, you know, relatively low on the overall satisfaction slash usability and requirement scale. Let's look into that. Oh, and hey, there's comments right here that tell me exactly what the problems are. So that was a super, super valuable activity. It was relatively time consuming, but it was worth every moment to set that up.
And I think when Nick's done with the scorecard is great way to digitize. You know, I talked about a failure in data we had. It actually turned into a success when we found out that people were using the tool and they didn't like it, and we sat down with them and they said, well, we hate it. Well, we asked them, what do you hate about it? And it was really some minor things. And we fixed those things, we rolled it out, and now it's our most used tool in the application as of this month. So, and it happened within a couple weeks too. So I think if you really sit down with people, which is what our job is, to sit down and have empathy for a problem that someone is having and figure and come up with a viable solution for them, then you'll have wins. But you know, sometimes the failed data is what will lead you there.
So as with the problem that I had with that slide deck, like the data for me tells me the what. I don't know the why. I never know the why until I talk to people. So for us, we get all of these data points and they give us a place to start and maybe guide us towards the right questions to ask. And those are the questions that we can either go back and ask the data again, tweak some things, but truly where you get that really rich qualitative stuff is when you talk to the user. So for us, it's the beginning point for where we're going to start that conversation, either with internal stakeholders or with end users of the product. And that's why we pair that qualitative and quantitative research every sprint for us. So we have these hypotheses, we talk to these people, we came up with what's wrong, and we came up with what our opportunities are, and now we're gonna iterate on that. So that is like, it's a regular daily pairing of quant and qual data for us.
That's awesome. I don't need a mic. I want to take a pause because I think we're kind of close to our time cap. You know, but I want to make sure that if anybody has any questions from the audience here, in case there's something topical, we can keep going. But if anybody had anything they wanted to know specifically from anybody up here?
What about like challenges that you guys are facing right now, making use of analytics?
Go for it. If you wanted to,
I just needed to
think about that question.
As I mentioned before, so this is really important to me, is transparency within the organization. And it came up with that, like, the siloed analytics team at Wells Fargo. I feel like that's a problem that I think a lot of organizations have, because often the analytics team is short-staffed or they're a bottleneck. And so one of the reasons we chose Pendo, and this is kind of going to be a Pendo pitch, was because I could give out as many seats in my organization as I wanted. So for me, transparency of data within the organization was a high priority, because I wanted everyone to be able to ask the questions of the data that they wanted, because a PM might have a different question from a UX, might have a different question from the development team wants to know about performance, the QA team wants to be able to communicate about releases, the UX team wants to understand behavior, and for us, the documentation team now wants to have a say in what's happening in those guides. So the way that I did it at my organization was, we have a weekly product podcast, and so we presented what we had done so far in Pendo across our products, and then announced that whoever wants an account can just email me and I'll give you a read-only account. And then if you are working on that product, I would give you more permissions in that account. So in addition to making sure that you're providing relevant data to folks who are maybe not wanting to play around with data, giving people access to play with data who maybe have never had that opportunity is really powerful, because then they're able to, you know, even just understand what we could possibly know from the data. And so that provides, not only does it break down silos between teams, but you're also like jumping out of product over into marketing. You're having developers starting to talk to UXers on a more regular basis, and you're having product managers really partner and collaborate with the folks that are working in the products. And I know a lot of those are huge challenges in really big organizations, and that data, that's what I meant by the gateway drug. Data is just like, people can start talking about it and they can start collaborating on that really fast. So you drop that screenshot in with the heat map and everybody is into that conversation.
Did you have something to add?
Yeah. You're opening the floor up to this interesting question. We're still really early, so I think a lot of folks have already figured out the answer, but we're still in the page tagging phase of analytics. And what we're finding is that our URLs are kind of squirrely sometimes if we're going through the setting of wildcards properly. And one of the things that I'm concerned about is how exactly Pendo is counting, so I'm not getting like three, you know, page views when it was really only one, or vice versa. Some not being a positive that the data is right. I'm just curious if you guys ever experienced that and how you kind of made peace with it.
I'd call my Pendo person. I have had that squirrely URL situation, and I've just had to reach out and be like, can you help me understand this? Yeah, because it's out of my depth, and I think even the developers and I, we were going back and forth. You know, I had broken something at some point and was reaching out to the developers, and they were scratching their heads too. So I just kept tweaking stuff until the data showed up for me. At that point, I would just reach out to, I email them all the time.
Yeah. Question?
Yeah, quick question on the concern.
Go ahead.
On the data.
So we have many products, as I said, and the one that was the fastest was the marketing website, because people really care about where people are clicking and how they're getting to that contact the sales team page. So that, I tagged that in a couple hours, And then I showed a heat map to the marketing team, and no, and you know, it took them, like, I gave them accounts a month ago. They never looked, and they didn't look until I showed them that heat map on the homepage. Nobody cared until I was like, "Here's your heat map." So that was a really quick win. For the once we got the demo within our organization, we had a committee that was selecting the analytics tool. We were sold. We actually didn't see any other tools after that. We had done our research, so we knew there were other ones out there. But after they showed us the guides, we didn't want to see anything else. And depending on whether or not that's a value, that's the selling point. But in our really big product, it took a long time to tag the pages. It's not done. It's like 20%. But we're still seeing wins there. I have a colleague here. Can you confirm that, like in Civic Platform? It's like 20% tagged. But in another less complex product, I tagged 80% in a couple days. Just me.
20%, yeah. How long did that take?
Weeks. Yeah.
It's still in the realm of weeks, days, not months.
Well, months since we started it, but like weeks tagging. Yeah.
One thing to add to that, I think if you have, you know, if you're trying to figure out time to value, I think you really have to dedicate some resources to be in charge of your Pendo instance, if you will, to really be successful, because it can be overwhelming. And you know, I would talk to Pendo about their TAMs, and they can offer you guys support for additional fee, but. So I think that's very valuable to do that. And then the other thing we were having discussion about is, you know, with all this tagging stuff, you tagging all this thing. I mean, I had one of my newer UI UX guys go in and just tag everything he could find, right? And then we realized you tagged the wrong things. And I think I kind of spoke to your question, because you got to understand how your application works and know how you want to tag it. And then what you want to do is, even before you start tagging, you probably want to have some standardization and naming convention of how to tag things and how to categorize. So thank you to Pendo for adding the categories. Yeah, that helped a ton. Mm-hmm.
Do you have any best practices on that, like tagging divs or individual objects? Have you learned anything pass along?
You know, I think, again, it's going to be really specific to your application, how it works, and with your URL structure and whatever. But I kind of found that I really wanted to take each page as a page and then lay features out on that page separately. And I didn't honestly call out all the features on the page. I just called out the key, the specific ones that I want to know about, because there's so much data. I wanted to pare it down to just get some use out of it and get some value out of it, instead of turning my wheels because I've got so much data and a small team to do it with.
Mm-hmm. There's another question.
Yeah, rolling into the last couple questions, the statement.
I mean, we kind of did that a little bit, where we tagged, we did some analysis, we reevaluated. The only thing is that in our organization, it was a large organization, and we would have probably benefited from a little bit more of an upfront strategy and then a big bang approach. So it all depends on what kind of organization. Like if you have a little bit more runway before you need to show value, then that'll be okay. But if you've got to show value right away because maybe your executives are more cost conscious, then I would say start with a strategy and get buy-in. Another thing that Nova was talking to me beforehand about was basically like you developed questions for each of your departments. So like, hey, what is a question that you product really want to know, really want to answer about how people are using the application? Marketing, what questions would you like to answer? So then you have these very important business-oriented questions for each department, and once you have those questions, you can go and answer them in Pendo, and now you're showing value across the entire organization, and that's very important if you have cost-conscious executives. But in terms of lean, I think it really depends on what kind of situation you've got at your company.
And for us, I think by default, we had to do it lean because my goal is to get Pendo into as many products as I can before they want to stop signing those POs. So I'm just moving from product team to product team, getting Pendo in, and unfortunately leaving a bit of a trail of like, hey, what are we supposed to do with this data? So my colleague Harish, who's in the back of the room, is actually working with the teams. He's working with one team to make sure that they are being really strategic about the data. So even though 20% of it's tagged, I would call that pretty lean in terms of, you know, the most value we want to get out of that product. But working with the product managers to understand exactly how they want to be strategic about gathering that data and then being iterative about tagging things. And then I'm working, and the goal is to have best practices to come out of that for every single product team. So that's how we're trying to be iterative about it.
Yes.
So earlier, Nicholas, you mentioned the trouble you guys have had with your navigation, where you noticed that users were picking the wrong categories. What strategy did you use to identify that kind of failure case for a user's use of your product or feature?
You mean how specifically did I look at Pendo to determine that people were like having trouble using the navigation?
Yeah, distinguishing between using the navigation, selecting the correct category versus.
Right. Good, great question. So the paths feature is fantastic. It shows you what. So I just went and I spent a couple days and tagged every page that I could myself, so that I knew it was done right. And then features. I tagged every feature that is all around the wrapper, the Chrome, everywhere. And what I saw is basically the paths shows you whether they hit a feature or a page. And so I saw that the very, people who click the feature of this one particular top nav category, the very next thing that was tagged that they did was another feature of the top nav category, not a page. I mean, if they had done the right thing, presumably they would have chosen a category and then gone to another page, and they didn't. Yeah.
I think we're actually, we're at time. So any concluding thoughts? Any parting words?
I think parting words. Use guides. Use guides. Guides are amazing. You should all use them. I think you should all use guides. We saw some really great presentations on using guides this morning. That's I'm super passionate about it. So that's my pitch.
All right. Well, thank you guys.